Yet Jesus went to the cross, dying for us when we were still his enemies. We're so thankful, God, that you love us that much. We're thankful that when we cry out to you for salvation, you save us, you give us a home in heaven, and you promise to be with us. And Lord, we just pray this morning that as we sing about that amazing love, it would just fill our hearts, fill our voices, and we would just sing for your honor and for your glory this morning. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's go ahead and stand up. Take a moment, turn around, greet your neighbor, and then we are going to praise the Lord together.
Thank you, Pastor. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is amazing. Steady and unchanging, your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, your love makes me sing.
Woo, good morning, Grace Church. You might see me dancing around up here. I'm just trying to get warm, that's all. It's funny because most of the rest of these songs aren't nearly as fast, so I'll be dancing slow. Sorry. How's everybody doing this morning?
Good.
Yeah? Better than I deserve. Thank you, Brent. I almost said your name wrong. Bart. Sorry, Bart. All right. See if you guys remember this one.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Very nice. Thanks, guys. Isn't he awesome? Well, let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day. And Lord, in light of all the situations that are taking place globally, within our country, Lord, that we wouldn't focus so much on that. But Lord, know that we have hope in you. Lord, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the chief cornerstone. God, you are the Most High, you are the High Priest. And Lord, we thank you because we get to partake of that if we turn our hearts to you. So be with Pastor Brian this morning. He brings forth the message, Lord, that we would hear and receive it and live it. Lord, you are good and we love you. We give you the highest praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You can stand or sit, however you feel. Thank you, brother.
Amen.
Good job.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, it's just so undeniable alive. I can hardly speak a peace so unexplainable alive. Can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You're a good, good Father. A good, good Father. A good, good Father. To us.
Amen. Yes, I'm still shivering. All right.
broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
What a wonderful sacrifice.
Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling.
Oh,
oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born. The precious blood of Jesus Christ will come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Jesus is calling.
Let's give the Lord a hand, will we?
Thank you. Well, that was awesome, praise team. Thank you very much. I love that. I forgot to ask the guys if they were going to show the Operation Christmas Child video today, or we'll do it next week. We can do it next week. That's fine. I didn't warn them. Well, it's nice to see everybody here this morning. Hopefully you were praying for me this week, because, I tell you, when Pastor Dan leaves and tells people I'm going to preach, sometimes they don't show up. So thanks for coming. I appreciate that. Well, I'm going to start this morning. I'm going to ask you kind of a silly question, you might think, but it kind of fits into what we're talking about, and that is, how many of you enjoy going to the dentist or the doctor? What's wrong with you, Cooper? Oh, man. Most of us probably don't, right? We don't enjoy having to go to the dentist or the doctor. You know, typically we don't go until there's something wrong or until there's a lot of pain, right? We should go before we get to that point, but we're a little stubborn, and I know I'm that way too, especially when it comes to the dentist. To this day, I have a terrible fear of the dentist. I'd rather just about do anything than go to the dentist. And I think part of that, when I was young, you know, when everybody else's baby teeth loosen up and fall out, mine didn't loosen up. So my permanent teeth were coming in, but they weren't coming out. So the doctors had to pull, the dentist had to pull 11 or 12 teeth when I was little, and man, that just kind of scarred me for life. To this day, I dread going to the dentist, you know, and we don't like going, but when we do, typically we feel better, and then we're glad that we did. We're glad we went to the dentist or to the doctor until we get the bill. And then it's like, oh, man. But I found something interesting when you talk about some of those professions. It's interesting how we refer to them. Like, if you go to a lawyer, often it's referred to as like a law practice or the medical practice or a dental practice. And you think, wait a minute, I don't want you just practicing on my teeth. I want professionals working on me or whatever they're going to do. But, I forgot to dismiss the kids to the edge. Okay. Kids, you may head to the edge. Oh. See, I got talking about a dentist and just got all flustered. So, it's interesting, though, that we refer to those careers as medical practice, dental practice, law practice. And at first, like I said, that used to drive me nuts. It's like, wait a minute, if you're just practicing, why am I paying so much money? But then I thought, well, now, it's good that they are a dental practice or a medical practice, because if they're continually practicing, that means they're using the newest and latest technologies. And don't we want doctors to use the best available medicines, the best available technology to work on us? So it's a good thing. You know, if they were not progressing in their career, we would say something's wrong, right? If they're not learning more, if they're not growing, we would say something's wrong. So that idea I want to compare with our spiritual walk. So I want to ask you a couple of questions this morning. Are you practicing your faith? Are you daily practicing what you believe in? Are you progressing as a Christian? Are you growing in your faith every single day? We should be, right? We should be constantly growing. And really, that's the subject of the message this morning. We're going to talk about sanctification, and specifically progressive sanctification. And you might be saying, well, what is that? Maybe you know what sanctification is, but not what progressive sanctification is. So let's get a few kind of definitions down first. And if you have your sermon notes, the first two are already typed in there for you. But sanctification means to be set apart. It also has the idea of holiness, to be holy, to be set apart. And for a believer, it can be a one-time event, right? The moment you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the moment of your conversion, you are sanctified. You are set apart. So it can be referred as people or as objects. For instance, we are sitting in the sanctuary. That comes from that word sanctification. This room has been set apart for the place we come to worship God. So it's been set apart. The moment, like I said, that you ask Jesus into your heart, that's the moment. Well, first, that's justification. You've been declared righteous by God, and sanctification begins in your life at that very moment. So we have been set apart unto God. So in that sense, it is a one-time event. Now, progressive sanctification, that is when we daily progress and become more Christ-like. We are to be more Christ-like every single day. So sanctification is to be set apart. It's a one-time event. And for the believer, it happens at conversion. But progressive sanctification is the daily process of becoming more Christ-like, and that should be a continual process in our lives. We should be more like Christ today than we were yesterday, than we were last year, than we were last week. And it's something that we're always growing towards. We are progressing. So let me give you kind of an example of what progressive sanctification might look like. I told Jack I was only going to pick on him once, and he's probably out there hiding, but many of you know Jack Myers, good buddy of mine. I've known Jack for about 20 years. Well, there he is. He was so short I didn't see him. But he's a good friend of mine. We've done a lot of fishing together. Really, I taught him all he knows about crappie fishing. Just don't let him fool you. Truth be known, he taught me an awful lot about crappie fishing. But I remember many, many years ago, Jack had double knee replacement surgery, and I went to see him in the hospital. And some of his family was there, of course, and when I went to see him that day, his youngest son, Kelly, was there, and I had never seen Kelly before. I'd never talked to Kelly before, didn't know him at all. So when I went to the hospital and I met him for the first time, I knew right away that was Jack's son. He kind of talked like Jack. He had a lot of the same mannerisms. He even looked like Jack. And I told him, that's really unfortunate. But I'm kidding about that. But I knew, just looking at Kelly, I was like, that's Jack's son. There was no doubt in my mind that that was Jack's son. It was obvious. Now, that's how it should be with believers. When people look at you, they should be able to tell that you belong to Christ. They should be able to see that we're Christians. Do we look like Jesus? Do we act like Jesus? Do we talk like Jesus? If someone met you for the first time and just talked to you for a few minutes, would they know that you are a Christian? They should, right? They should be able to tell. There's something different about that person. They should be able to tell that that person is a Christian. I think too often what happens, though, is a person gets saved, they rejoice, they're on fire for the Lord, and then over time, they just sort of become stagnant. They stop growing. They stop progressing in their faith, right? They kind of remain as babes in Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, Paul says this, "Brothers," and we could say brothers and sisters, believers, "I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men?" So, are we progressing daily? Are we maturing in our faith? Are we becoming more Christ-like? Are we becoming more like Jesus? Or are we still just like those infants that aren't growing? In John 10, verse 10, Jesus said this, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Is that true of you today? Would you say that you are experiencing that abundant, full life? You know, as believers, we've been given the greatest gift of all. We should just be rejoicing and abundant every single day. But again, a lot of times I think we just sort of are content with where we are with the Lord. We don't really change that much. We don't really grow. 2 Peter 3:18, this is one of my favorite verses in Scripture. It says, "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory, both now and forever. Amen." Now that's worded there as a command, "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." So again, my question, are you growing? Are you growing? Do you know more about Jesus today than you did a year ago? Are you closer to Him now than you were last week? Or, if we're honest, do we have to say sometimes, you know, I've just kind of been staying the same. I'm just staying the same. I think, unfortunately, a lot of times, myself included, we kind of don't grow. We just seem to be content with where we are with Jesus. And I think a lot of us today are suffering from what I call the three C's, which is chronic complacent Christianity. The three C's. Chronic complacent Christianity. Chronic means all the time. Complacent, that means we're not growing. We're not progressing. We're not bearing fruit. We're not becoming more Christ-like. And if it's true that a lot of Christians today are in this situation where they're experiencing chronic complacent Christianity, well, then what do we do about it? What's the antidote? How do we fix this debilitating disease? Well, we're going to be in Philippians chapter 3 today. So I've got all the verses we need in our notes, but if you have your Bible, you might want to turn there. Philippians chapter 3, And I'm going to be sharing verses 10 through 21. Now, before I get into those specific verses that we're going to talk about today, I want to give you just a quick outline of chapter 3, of Philippians chapter 3. I'm not going to be reading the whole thing, so it is interesting, though, this outline can be broken into three parts, and all three of these parts kind of are these big churchy words that we sometimes use, okay? So we're going to talk about these three words. The first one, and this is on your sermon notes there, the first one is justification. Justification. And the definition that I want you to write for this one is this. Justification is when we are saved from the penalty of sin. Justification means saved from the penalty of sin. So in verses 1 through 9 of chapter 3, it's all about justification. Justification means declared righteous. We are declared righteous. Verse 9 in Philippians 3 says this, to be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. So we are declared righteous by faith in Jesus Christ. It's not of ourselves, it's not any of our works, it's through Christ. So justification means that believers are saved from the penalty of sin. So the moment you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have been saved from the penalty of sin, right? Romans 8:1 says, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So when you get saved, boom, right now, no condemnation. You are justified. Now the second part, which is going to be the meat of the message today, is in verses 10 through 19, and that is sanctification. Sanctification, here's the definition, being saved from the power of sin. Being saved from the power of sin. So sanctification means to be set apart, to become more Christ-like, and it means that the believer is being saved from the power of sin, right? The more Christ-like you become, you should sin less in your life. Now, I've often told people, we'll never be sinless this side of heaven. Never. But the closer you are with Jesus, the closer you walk to him, you should sin less each day, right? We don't keep on sinning because we know we're justified. No, we should sin less. So, justification, saved from the penalty of sin. Sanctification, we are being saved from the power of sin. It should have less power over us the closer we are to Jesus. And then thirdly, glorification. Glorification, we're going to see specifically in verses 20 through 21. And here's the definition. Completely saved from the presence of sin. That's what glorification means. Completely saved from the presence of sin. Right? Glorification is to be with Jesus in heaven in our glorified bodies. And that's our hope. We know that's going to happen one day. Glorification happens when believers will one day be completely saved from the presence of sin. Won't that be a great day? When you no longer have to struggle with sin. Because it'll be done away with. So those are the three things that I like to remember. Justification, saved from the penalty of sin. Sanctification, being saved from the power of sin. And glorification, completely saved from the presence of sin. So with that, now I'd like to read Philippians 3, verses 10 through 21, before we break it apart verse by verse. So here we go. Philippians chapter 3, verses 10 through 21. And this is the Apostle Paul speaking. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. For as I have often told you before, and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, by the power that enables Him to bring everything under His control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like His glorious body. Let's pray together this morning. Heavenly Father, we just thank You so much for the privilege again of being here this morning. Lord, to be able to sing praises to Your name, to be able to read from Your Word. And God, we just ask that You would just be with us today. Give us understanding. Give us insight, Lord. I pray that we would be challenged by the Scripture this morning. Lord, that we would have a desire to know You more, Lord. As Paul said, to know You more each and every day. Lord, I pray that You would just help us, Lord, to draw closer to You today and every day, Lord, from this time on, that we would desire to be more like You every single day. Lord, I want to pray today that You'd be with Pastor Dan and Cheryl. I'm so thankful they had a chance to take a vacation and get away for a bit. Pray they had a good time in Michigan and that You'd get them back home safely. Lord, we just pray that You would continue to be with the church here. We thank You so much for all that You've done in our church, in our lives. And pray, God, that we would, Lord, just be grateful for all that You've done. And I pray this morning, God, that You, again, would just open our eyes, open our hearts. Help us, Lord, to learn Your Word better and that we could go out and share it with somebody else. Lord, we thank You. We love You. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so we're going to look at the antidote for chronic complacent Christianity. That means those of us, maybe a lot of us, I know it's been myself at times, but we're not growing in our faith. We're just kind of stagnant. Well, the first thing, letter A, we're going to look at power. Letter A is power. Verse 10, again, Paul says, I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death. Power. You know, the Bible has a lot to say about the power of God. In Genesis, we see His creative power, right? I mean, what kind of power just speaks everything into existence? That's pretty awesome power. We see His power in Exodus, right? His mighty hand, He brings the plagues upon the Egyptians. He parts the Red Sea and the Israelites walk across on dry land and then brings the waters crashing back in on the Egyptians. Power, the power of God. And all through the Old and New Testament, we see God's miraculous power. But I think it's interesting here in Philippians chapter 3 that Paul doesn't say, I want to know Christ and His creative power. He doesn't say, I want to know Christ and His miraculous power. No, instead, he says, I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection. I find that interesting. Now, what is the power of the resurrection? Well, it's when Jesus, who lived a perfect life, He came to this earth, lived the perfect life, died on the cross for our sins, was buried and defeated death in the grave, and rose from the grave. He defeated sin, defeated death. That's an amazing power, right? 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God, the power of the cross, the power of the resurrection. That's a pretty amazing power, right? The message of the cross is the power of the resurrection. And all believers have that same power living inside of us. If you ever stop and think about that, that same power that raised Jesus from the grave, the power of the resurrection, is the power that's living in every believer this morning. That's pretty astounding when you think about that. But oftentimes, instead of realizing that and turning to that power that we have, what do we do instead? Well, we try to live out the Christian life in our own power and in our own strength. You know, I don't think it helps that we live in a country where we hear all the time, you can do anything, right? Pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You have the power. We don't have the power not to live the Christian life. It's all of Jesus. It's all of God. So we try oftentimes to live this Christian life, this walk in our own power and strength, and that is so foolish. You know, I remember when my older brother and I were young, we grew up in La Villa, a little tiny town. Probably at 9 and 10 years old, we started working. We mowed lawns every summer. We shoveled walks. We delivered the daily Atomo Courier, the Sunday Des Moines Register. We were working when we were young. And, you know, when you're 9 or 10 years old, those push mowers are kind of heavy. So we would mow these lawns all the time, right? Made a lot of money, and we were all about that. And I remember the first time my dad got a self-propelled push mower. And I thought, I don't want to use that. You know, I've always done it this way. This is how you should do it. This is I can do it. I got the power. And then I tried that self-propelled mower, and man, did it make it easy, right? You just held on and whew, it just took off. And I thought, you know, how foolish was I that I'd want to keep pushing that lawn in my own strength, my own power, when really all I had to do was just let the power of the mower work through me. Same thing's true of Christians. Why do we try to live this life in our own power and our own strength when we just need to let God's power work through us, right? It's His power. We need to stop trying to live this Christian life in our own strength and our own power. And again, I've been so guilty of this in the past, right? We can be so busy and work so hard and think we're doing all these things on our own, and usually we end up defeated, discouraged, tired, worn out, because we're not trusting in the power of God. Philippians 4:13, another one of my favorite verses. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. It doesn't say I can do all things in my strength if I work hard enough. No, it's I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. That's our power, right? That's our power, the power of the resurrection. Ephesians 3:20 says this, to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us. So maybe this morning, if you're being honest, you'd have to say, yeah, I'm kind of in that chronic complacent Christianity mode. I'm tired. I'm worn out. Could be you're trying to do it all in your own power and your own strength. And it's never going to work. We are going to fall short every single time. So we need to trust in His power, in God's power, the power of the resurrection. So that's our first step. Don't rely on your power. No, rely on God's power, the power of the resurrection. Secondly, letter B is pursuit. Pursuit. In verses 11 through 13, Paul goes on and he says, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead, not that I have already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. So the second step in overcoming chronic complacent Christianity is our pursuit. It's our pursuit. And I love, Paul says, not that I have already been made perfect, but I press on. Now we might say, well, wait a minute. If there's ever anybody that was perfect or close to being perfect, it was Paul, right? No, Paul wasn't perfect either. He said, I press on. Some other translations say, I follow after, or I make every effort. I press on. That Greek word for I press on was used of a sprinter, and it refers to aggressive, energetic action. It's been a long time since I was sprinting, I'll tell you that. But to be a sprinter, it takes a lot of aggressive, energetic action, right? Paul pursued sanctification with all his might. Paul said, I press on twice in this passage. I press on. I press on. I strain toward what lies ahead. So he was never content just knowing the Lord as a Savior. He kept pressing on to know Him more, to know Him more fully. And that's a challenge, you know, because it's easy to think, well, I've been a Christian since I was 8 years old. Yeah, you can always know more about Jesus. You can always know more about the Bible. We should always be pressing on, straining to know Him more fully. You know, I think too many times believers aren't progressing with the Lord and in their walk with the Lord because they either can't get past their failures or they're content with where they are. Right? You know, Paul said, one thing I do. This is pretty important. Here's the one thing. Forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. I think sometimes we are ineffective in our Christian walk, or we're not growing because we have not forgotten, right? We need to forget what's behind. Too many times we remember what we were like or the things we did, the sins that we were involved in. And if you've confessed that and God's forgiven you, then you need to forget it. It's done. It's gone. But so many times we bring it back up. So you got to forget what's behind. Now, that also means you need to forget about your past achievements. You know, you might say, well, I did this and this and this and this. But then I might say, well, what are you doing now? What have you done lately? Because people just get content with where they are with the Lord. So forgetting what is behind, straining toward what lies ahead. We have to Forget about those sins, because if you've confessed it, it's gone. You shouldn't be bringing it up again and feeling guilty, because Jesus took care of that. But we also don't need to rely on our past achievements. That's a big mistake as well. You know, a lot of times, like I said, people will say, well, I'm good with the Lord. I got saved years ago. I'm good with God. And then nothing happens. They don't change. They don't get closer to Him. They don't grow in their faith. And that's a real problem. So the problem is that they have not progressed beyond that point. So if we're stuck in the past or we're relying on the past, how in the world are you going to be effective in the present or the future? Right? So one thing I do, forgetting what is behind, and I press on. You got to press on. Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2 says this, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before Him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. That's all about our pursuit. Our pursuit. I love that. Hebrews, we don't know for sure the writer of Hebrews. I believe it was probably the Apostle Paul, but we don't know for sure. But if it is Paul, interesting that he's talking about the same thing. He said, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. So, what hinders you? What sin entangles you? You know, that's between you and God, but I imagine for a lot of us, there is something that hinders us, a sin that just seems to keep tangling me up. And he says, it's very clear, throw it off. Throw off everything that hinders. Get rid of any sin that entangles us. And let us run with perseverance. You know, I think sometimes as Christians, we're guilty of saying, well, it's all of God. Now, salvation is by grace through faith alone. That is of God. But you have a responsibility once you're saved. That is to run with perseverance. Exactly what Paul says here. Let us run with perseverance, the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. And I think a lot of times when we are complacent, when we're not growing, our eyes aren't on Him. We've taken our eyes off of Jesus completely. We're not running with perseverance. So my question this morning is, how's your pursuit? What are you pursuing? You know, sometimes we pursue things that aren't necessarily bad, but it doesn't draw us closer to Jesus either. You know, for a lot of people, what are you pursuing? Well, I want the good job, the big house, the money in the bank account. That's what we pursue. And we need to make sure that we are pursuing the things of God, pursuing Him. So if we want to overcome chronic complacent Christianity, we got to throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles and run with perseverance the race marked out for us. So progressive sanctification, it's a quote that I found this week and I thought, man, this is so true. Progressive sanctification happens only when we are dissatisfied with our present spiritual condition. Because too many times we're just happy with where we are. But really, progressive sanctification only happens when we are dissatisfied with our present spiritual condition. We need to press on. Our goal should always be, I want to know Jesus more than I do right now. I want to know more of His Word than I do right now. I want to be closer to Jesus than I am right now. So we press on. We fix our eyes on Jesus. The third thing is letter C, and that is the prize. The prize. In verses 14 through 16, Paul goes on and says, I press on. Here's the second time he said that. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. So the third step in overcoming chronic complacent Christianity is the prize. He said, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. So what's the prize? Well, what's the goal? He talks about two things there. What's the prize? What's the goal? The goal should be Christ-likeness here and now, that I would be more like Jesus Christ here and now. The prize is perfect Christ-likeness in heaven one day with Jesus. That's the prize, to be with Him and to be like Him. Right? That should be our prize. I love it says there in that section that we are to live up to what we have already attained. And you might think, well, what's that mean for sure? What's that mean? Well, what has the believer already attained? Well, justification. You've been saved, right? Sin, you've been saved from death. You've been saved from hell if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. We have so many blessings from God, right? We have His Word. We can be in His Word every day. We are part of His family. We have so many blessings. So are we living each day in gratitude for all that God is and all that He has done? We ought to be the most thankful people every single day for all that God has done, right? If He did nothing else for you, He saved you from hell. That's a reason to rejoice every single day. I think, again, sometimes we just become too complacent. We become too worldly. We become stagnant in our walk with the Lord. I think a lot of people are like, well, I got a home in heaven. I'm good. And that's it. They're happy with where they are right now. But we should be progressing daily. I want to be more like Jesus. I want to know His Word more. I want to be a prayer warrior. I want to be closer to Him. That's what the goal should be. So the goal is to become more Christ-like every single day. That should be the goal. Now, will we ever completely achieve that goal here on earth? No. We're not ever going to be sinless this side of heaven. And I think many times believers become discouraged when we sin. We fall short. We say, well, what's the use? I'm never going to be able to do this. Well, and typically, that's because we're trying to live it in our own strength. We're trying to rely on our own power, not God's power. But the idea that we're not going to live up to His standards, well, that's why it's called progressive sanctification. Daily, we need to try to be closer to God. You're not going to, you know, be just godly like that. No, it's a pursuit. It's a daily walk where we are striving to be more like Him. It's a lifelong, daily process. So our goal should be to become more like Jesus. Now, that prize, though, I think sometimes, too, that prize, we sometimes think, well, heaven, I'll have that someday. No, you have that right now. You have the guarantee, right, of heaven. It's yours right now. The prize is to be face-to-face with Jesus, to be with Him, to be like Him. In verses 20 and 21, here's the prize. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, by the power that enables Him to bring everything under His control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like His glorious body. You ever feel like you just have a lowly old body here on earth? I was talking this morning with a gentleman out there. We were, you know, well, I have these aches and pains, and it's getting a little worse as I get older, and hopefully you don't have too many, but I'll tell you what, I'm looking forward to heaven one day where there'll be no more pain, no more sorrow, no more aches, none of that, right? That's the prize. Paul says our citizenship is in heaven. You are a citizen of heaven right now. And we're not there physically, but it's a done deal. You've been guaranteed heaven if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. So, to be in heaven, to be with Jesus, to be like Him. But when we take our eyes off Jesus, we lose sight of the prize. When we fix our eyes on the things of the world, we lose sight. We aren't growing as we should be. We got to remind ourselves, this world, it's not our home. That beautiful house you have, it's not your home. That's just your temporary dwelling place. As a believer, your home is in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven. So Paul told the Philippian believers that they should live according to the pattern of godly men in those verses we just read, right? Not those that were ungodly. He said in verse 19 that their minds are on earthly things. And again, I think that's when we suffer the most from chronic, complacent Christianity, when we have our minds on earthly things. We need to get our eyes off of everything that's happening on the earth and fix them on Jesus, fix them on heaven. A good life here and now is not the prize. That's not the prize. The ultimate prize is heaven in the very presence of Jesus. So, the three things again: power, pursuit, and prize. How can we apply this to our lives today? How can we apply this? Well, I want to read one more passage, and it's a pretty lengthy one, but I put it in your bulletin, and I think this goes along really perfectly with what we've been talking about today. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 11. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he is nearsighted and blind, and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. A couple things that jumped out there to me. First one was, his divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness. The question there on the, how can you apply this to your life, where or what is your power? It's his power. It's his divine power. It's not your power. He has given us everything we need to live this life. It's his divine power. So if you're a believer here today, you already have that power within you. You have the power to live out this Christian life. We cannot try to live it in our own power, right? Only through the power of the resurrection. And if you're relying on your own power, then you're going to feel defeated and you're going to be complacent. You're going to be stagnant. You're not going to be growing. You're going to be ineffective. And it's interesting, in that middle section there that we just read in 2 Peter, if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive. That's definitely what we don't want to be, right? You know, last week I was in the Edge with the kids, so I had to listen to the message from the Dan Arce from Venezuela later in the afternoon, but wow, his whole message was about treasures and ashes, right? What the ashes kind of, to me, is this idea of, hey, you can be ineffective and unproductive in your walk with the Lord if we aren't having our eyes fixed on Him and pursuing the things of God. Speaking of that, what are you pursuing? What should we be pursuing? Well, we should be pursuing His divine nature. And you might say, well, what's that? That's kind of vague. I don't know what His divine nature is. Well, it lists it there, right? It says, make every effort. Again, that's the idea of pursuit. Make every effort. Strive. Press on. Make every effort to do what? Well, to add to your faith goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. Make every effort to add those things to your faith. And that only happens when we are in the Word every single day. We're reading it, we're studying it. Happens when we spend time in prayer. Happens when we spend time with brothers and sisters in a Bible study. We need to be growing and progressing in our faith. Otherwise, we might be ineffective and unproductive. And nobody wants that, right? Nobody wants that, or we shouldn't want that. So, what are you pursuing today? Are you storing up treasures here on earth? The Bible tells us that's foolish, right? If you store up treasures on earth where moth and rust break in and thieves break in and destroy, it doesn't do us any good. We need to lay our treasures up in heaven. Don't ever be satisfied with where you are with the Lord. Don't be satisfied with where you are right now. You can always know Him more. You can grow in your faith. You can become more Christ-like, and that's what we should be all about. Always press on that we would know Him more fully. Just as Paul said, I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection. He wanted to know Him more. So, it's His divine power. It's His divine nature. And then finally, what's the prize? His eternal kingdom, right? The very last part there in 2 Peter. For if you do these things, you will never fall, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We cannot be short-sighted. This world is not our home. And we become complacent when we become content with where we are right now. We got to make sure that we're not putting our faith in our job, in our wealth, in our health, and anything in this world, because those things are all so temporary and can be gone so quickly. The prize is being with Jesus for all eternity. So, progressive sanctification. The goal? Christ-likeness here and now. So, ask yourself, you don't need to tell me, but are you like Christ? Do you look like Christ? Do you talk like Christ? Would people know you're a Christian if they just saw you and talked to you for a few minutes, or would they have no clue? It ought to be so apparent that we belong to Him. So our goal is Christ-likeness here and now. And the prize, it's not all the stuff here on this earth, even though, you know, we have a lot of things. The prize is perfect Christ-likeness with Jesus one day in heaven. And we ought to be eagerly anticipating His return, where we get to be with Him for all eternity. Well, let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, I just thank You so much for Your word today. And Lord, when I heard the message last week from Pastor Dan Arce, Lord, it was convicting to know that one day all believers are going to stand before You at the beam of judgment. And You are going to look at what we did in our life. Did we have gold and precious metals and precious stones, or did we have wood, hay, and stubble? One of those gets burned up and is just ashes. Lord, I would pray that all of us this morning, Lord, would just want to be more like You every single day, grow closer to You every single day, that we would, Lord, lay our treasures up in heaven, not here on this earth. And God, I know, at least speaking for myself, there are many times when I am complacent. It's so easy just to think, well, I'm good. I know Jesus. I know I'm going to heaven. But then we stop growing. We stop becoming more like You. And Lord, I would pray that for me, for everyone in this room, our desire would be that when people meet us for the first time, they know something's different about us, that they would know that we are a Christian, that we belong to You. Lord, I pray that You would just conform us to the image of Your Son more and more every single day. And God, also remind us that Paul here said, I press on, I strive, I strain. Peter said, make every effort. Lord, it's not a matter of, well, I'm a Christian, I've got all these things. Well, we do need to still work. Lord, there is something that we need to do ourselves as well. We press on, that we would know You more fully. Lord, I pray that You would just help each one of us, that we would never be content with where we are right now, that we can always know You more. We can know You more fully. And then never to be content just knowing You, but to share that with somebody else. Many times I think we can study Your word and we can know a lot, but we don't ever share it. That's our job as well, that we would go out and tell others about Jesus Christ. So God, I pray that You would help us to do that. Lord, thank You for Your love. Thank You that You have given us everything we need to live this Christian life right now, if we rely on Your power, not our own power. And Lord, forgive us when we have tried to live out this Christian life in our own strength and our own power. We know we're going to fail. We know we're going to fall short. Lord, when we do, I pray that we would just confess that sin right away, Lord. And we know that You are faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, according to 1 John 1:9. So Lord, I just pray that our desire would be to be more Christ-like tomorrow than we were today, Lord. God, we just thank You so much for Your love. Thank You for working in our lives. And I pray that You would just continue, Lord, to draw us closer to Yourself and that we would desire to be more like You. And God, we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. One thing I forgot to show, I think the guys have a little picture I wanted to show you back there. Okay, sanctification. Conversion, right, that's justification, when we're declared righteous. Sanctification begins at that same moment. We are set apart to be holy. I like the quote at the bottom, sanctification is the work of a lifetime. We should be closer to God the longer we know Him. And I love that quote. We'll never be sinless this side of heaven, but we should sin less the longer we know Jesus and the more time we spend in His Word. So we need to make sure that we are walking in that every day, that we would desire to be more like Him. Last verse I also forgot. Here it is. Hebrews 12:4. I forgot to put it in your bulletin, but Hebrews 12:4 says this. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. That ought to be our desire, to be holy, to live that holy life, to be sanctified. All right. Well, let me give you a couple of quick announcements. The first one, it's coming up. I grabbed one of the Halloween tracks. I think this Friday night is the Trunk or Treat at the YMCA, and I know several of you have already signed up to help with that. We're going to be handing out some candy, handing out these gospel tracts, and it's got the message really clearly printed in there. It also has a little insert that Sherry printed off for us that has all of our services and things going on here at the church. So I'd ask that you'd be praying that when these get handed out, that they wouldn't just get thrown in the trash, that hopefully kids would look at it or their parents would, and who knows? Somebody might come to church just because we gave them a little piece of candy and this tract. So be praying for this one. And then on Monday night, which is trick-or-treat night here in town, two other spots, Mike Huff's house and Kathy Martin's house. There's going to be people at each one. And again, it's probably not too late to sign up if you want to go and help. I'm sure they would take all the people they could get. You got a question, Bart?
No.
Okay. So be... What's that? Oh, I gotcha. So be praying for that. That's a great opportunity and outreach where, you know, kids can get the gospel. And even if one reads it, it's worth it, right? One more person can come to know Jesus. So that's one thing to be praying about. The next thing, on November 5th, it's our Friends Day here at the church. And I don't know if these are, they were in the bulletin today too, I think, right? That's for you to hand to a friend to invite them to come to church on November 5th. The Jeff Arendale worship band is going to be here that day. We're going to have a big potluck following. And I believe it says in the bulletin there what you can bring. I think the main food, the main meat is all provided, but a side dish would be a good thing to bring if you can. And hey, let's invite our friends and neighbors. If you know somebody that doesn't go to church, hand them this. John? We do. Yep. Men's Bible study tomorrow night, 7 o'clock. We're still in the book of Matthew. Wednesday night, of course, we have all of our kids' activities, both preschool through fifth grade, and then we also have the junior high, high school meet at 7, and Phil's class meets over at the Christian school, right, 7 o'clock, okay? And then, of course, Thursday, we have the women's Bible study, two opportunities, one in the afternoon and one at the evening. I think the other thing that I don't want to forget on there is the today after the service still the group that meets out here? I think it said it in the bulletin, but is it? Yes, good. So there is a Bible study right after the service this morning, and I also see that there's a grief share. A grief group meets today at 4 o'clock at Pele Christian Counseling with Mike Huff. So if you're part of that, make sure you don't forget that. And then Operation Christmas Child, right? From now until November or through the third week of November, keep bringing in those supplies. And I see they put in here to make it easier. All the five categories start with the letter C. So craft, school items, cleanup items, clothing items, Christmas toys for girls, Christmas toys for boys. The more things that come in, the more they get to get shipped out and we can hopefully share the gospel with other people. Phil? For Friend Day? So we can plan for the food and everything? I gotcha. And next Saturday is our next men's breakfast and Bible study. So we had one of those a while ago, but this coming Saturday, we're going to have our next one. And I think there's a sign-up sheet. Or no, actually, it's the little slip in the bulletin. I think you're supposed to sign up if you're going to go so we know how much food to be prepared for. So Monty has an idea of how much food to cook. Okay, I think that's about everything. If I left something out, well, you can read it on your own, I guess. So. Guys, thanks for coming out today. Have a great week. God bless you.